My name is Gerry Knavy. I'm a member of the Galway Cumann of the National Party, and I would like to make a few comments on the ongoing lockdowns and the damage and the havoc that they are wreaking on people's lives, as well as paralysing the country in so many ways. First of all, I would like to make it clear that the damage, these lockdowns and the damage and the harm being caused by them are not the fault of the Gardaí, who are in the unfortunate position of having to enforce the restrictions. The fault lies fairly and squarely with our pathetic apology for a government. The most appalling aspect of government policy has been the way in which, for most of the past year, they have made people into a combination of prisoners and hermits by introducing draconian restrictions on domestic travel and movement and on social interaction, while at the same time allowing unrestricted travel into the country from abroad. There was a quite unforgettable film clip on TV news bulletins during one of last year's lockdowns, which showed new arrivals at Dublin Airport being handed forms by government officials on which they were invited to provide information regarding the addresses at which they intended to stay and the precautions they intended to take. They were asked to complete the forms and return them, but only if they felt like doing so. Incredibly, there was no legal obligation on these new arrivals, who could have come from the worst infected virus hotspots in the world, to even accept those forms, let alone complete and return them. It would have been hilarious if people living in the country were not being subjected to such harsh and oppressive restrictions at the same time as the airport pantomime was taking place. This sort of mind-boggling scenario continued month after month until now, when at last public anger and resentment has finally pressurised the government into some form of long overdue action. However, even now, the proposed government measures to introduce some controls on arrivals from abroad are typically limited, vague, half-baked, and lacking in clarity. These proposed measures bear all the hallmarks of a panicky, knee-jerk, make-it-up-as-you-go-along policy. Furthermore, they are being introduced at least 9 or 10 months too late. To illustrate the ongoing appalling government failure in this area, just consider the following. A report in a Sunday newspaper on January 31st last states that more than 2,000 people had travelled from Brazil to Ireland between Christmas week and late January. Of that number, that is 2,000 plus, 604 had come forward for testing, of which 52 had tested positive. As far as can be ascertained, the remaining 1,400 or 1,500 were free to roam the country at will. And remember that a deadly new strain of the virus has been discovered in Brazil. Yet, we the Irish people are supposed to live like prisoners and hermits. You couldn't make it up. You just couldn't make it up. You don't have to be a genius to realise that you can't control the spread of a global virus while allowing unrestricted entry into the country. The average 8-year-old could tell you that. Yet, that's exactly what the government has been trying to do for the past 10 months or more. All countries worldwide that have had what is considered low death and infection rates have had one thing in common. They have all implemented severe restrictions on entry into their country, including mandatory supervised quarantine in many cases. Yet our government has done the opposite, operating harsh oppressive restrictions, but only on the resident population. Well, maybe we shouldn't be too surprised at this. It is entirely consistent with the prevailing globalist, internationalist, border-free stance of the government and practically all the political establishment, where maintaining a globalist, politically correct stance takes priority over the lives and welfare of ordinary people, of ordinary Irish people. Taoiseach Michael Martin likes to proclaim the fact that he has no time for narrow nationalism. Well, he may have no time for narrow nationalism, but he doesn't seem to have any problem with broad treachery. The Taoiseach and his government would do well to reflect on the fact that their abject failure to restrict, regulate, or exercise any real control over incoming travel into this country over the past 10 months has almost certainly resulted in the unnecessary deaths of scores, if not hundreds, of Irish people. But even if they do reflect on that, I'm sure they will be consoled by the fact that at least they haven't been guilty of narrow nationalism. God forbid. There is another aspect of the lockdown that's worth looking at. There is no need to go on about the enormous economic damage that's being done. Everyone knows about that, even if it will take a while longer for the full impact to be realised and felt. Everyone is aware of the massive destruction of small businesses, with many hundreds, possibly thousands, already forced out of existence, and many more destined to follow the longer the lockdown lasts. This is dire news for thousands of decent, hard-working people. But it's not bad news for everybody. The big multinational corporations and chain stores are only too willing and too happy to expand and strengthen their ever-growing monopoly on the retail trade and on the overall commercial life of this country. We are only a few years away from a scenario where these multinational giants will have virtually the entire Irish market to themselves. After they have, in partnership with compliant Irish traitor governments, squeezed out practically all small indigenous businesses. The Irish political establishment and the multinationals have the same globalist, no borders outlook. So why should it be a surprise if the present Irish government uses prolonged lockdowns as a tool to destroy small businesses? Just look at the number of small businesses that have had to close over the past 20 or 30 years, overwhelmed by the imposition of endless EU rules, regulations and bureaucracy. Bear in mind also that small rural towns and villages are government targets for radical reshaping and transforming. This is largely because these towns and villages are homes to people who hold mainly traditional values based on patriotism, decency, wholesomeness, and respect. The very opposite to the so-called progressive agenda that glorifies degeneracy and perversion under the guise of promoting inclusion and diversity. The first steps in undermining and dismantling small rural communities have been underway for some years. The closing of Garda stations, post offices, reduction of public transport systems, lack of broadband, etc. Putting small Irish businesses out of existence is the next logical step in that treacherous progression. Bear in mind also that the more small businesses that close, government administration regarding matters like tax collection, employment legislation, health and safety, etc., become smaller, more streamlined, and obviously less costly. It is obviously far easier to deal with a handful of multinational giants with endless wealth than with thousands of diverse small businesses. While every Irish people should be aware of possible ulterior motives behind the lockdowns, small business owners and their representative organisations should be particularly so. Now, there are quite a number of ways in which there's huge damage being caused to this country by the lockdowns, especially long-term lockdowns. This takes many forms, including the disruption of education, domestic violence, etc. But perhaps the area in which the most tragic and wide-ranging damage being done by the ongoing lockdowns is in the area of mental health. Many thousands of people of all ages are in severe difficulty due to mental health damage, including a great many children. There was a recent article in the independent.ie headlined "Mental Health Tsunami as Children Struggle with Lockdowns." I will repeat that. Mental Health Tsunami as Children Struggle with Lockdowns. This report gives an indication of the scale of the problem and makes for harrowing reading. However, hearing such genuine horror stories make no impression on the government, or indeed the main opposition parties, whose attitude seems to be carry on with the lockdown. Indeed, many establishment politicians see nothing wrong with using the suffering of children in mother and baby homes in bygone years as a smokescreen to divert attention from the suffering imposed on present-day children by the lockdowns. The colossal damage being done to Irish society, on so many fronts now means that the supposed cure, i.e. lockdowns, is actually worse than the disease, the virus. The National Party has drawn up a number of alternative measures to deal with the present situation that are not punitive, oppressive or destructive. These measures include focused care of the elderly and vulnerable, putting more resources into ICU capacity, very tight travel restrictions on entry into the country, and approaching the matter on an all-Ireland basis. One thing is clear. If Irish people are ever to have governments that can be trusted to put the interest of our own people first, they must reject the currently established sellout political parties who will always give priority to globalism and political correctness over the interests of ordinary people. Irish people deserve better than oppression, depression, homelessness, joblessness and misery. National Party policies are geared to putting the Irish people first at all times. Yes, you're right.